As a result of the 14th of February Valentine's Day earthquake, we're down here in Christchurch. We're part of the GeoNet response. So my role has been to reassess the amount of material that may have fallen off some of the cliffs. There's a team of four of us down here, and the main objective is to A, work out how much volume has fallen off the cliffs in response to the earthquake, and B, to kind of work out how much the cliff tops have kind of moved backwards away from the cliff as material falls away. We can see a lot of damage to the cliff edge. We can see blocks of rock that are kind of teetering on the edge. We can see areas of fresh material that has fallen off. We can see piles of debris at the bottom of the cliffs. We can see cracks running across the cliffs. We can see cracks running at the cliff top. And we've seen tension cracks where the ground opens. What we're seeing with the successive earthquakes, the cliffs are getting progressively more damaged as time goes by and as the earthquakes occur. So what happens now is in earthquakes that may be similar size to earthquakes that have happened in the past, we're seeing bigger volumes of material fall off because the ground is more cracked. What we've seen from this event is that the damage has essentially been kind of contained to the areas that we've already mapped, and what it shows to us is the importance of these zones.
The liquefaction team has been working in the northern part of Christchurch in the Kaipoi area, mapping the liquefaction that appear on the surface on the 14th of February. Mapping the extent of liquefaction is very useful to evaluate what is the amount of shaken needed to trigger liquefaction. We can use helicopters or drones to do a first reconnaissance of what areas were affected by liquefaction so that we can have an idea where to go to map them in the field. A lot of these features are small or are very fragile, so they can disappear fast. Either people want to remove them from their homes or want to clean them out of the driveway. So for us it's extremely useful that if somebody sees liquefaction, brings that information to us as soon as possible. And one of the best things will be just to take a photo and send it to GeoNet. What we found this time is that some areas, despite being relatively far away from the epicenter, had substantial liquefaction, which means that those areas are highly susceptible.
Here in the geodetics team, we monitor the movement of the country due to the tectonic plate motions surrounding New Zealand. Since the original Darfield and Christchurch earthquakes, we have been remeasuring the survey points around Christchurch regularly. So after the most recent quake, we went back and measured a number of these points again. And this image here is some preliminary results from that latest survey. So here is the area surrounding Christchurch. The colours are derived from satellite imagery, and the arrows indicate movement at each of the survey marks that we've measured with GPS. So this line here indicates a point here which has moved a little bit less than 10 centimetres. This line here would be a little around about 1 centimetre. Here is an indication of what two centimetres looks like. So we almost have no movement here and here, and yeah, with the largest movement of 9 or 10 centimetres here, about 5 millimetres out towards the end of Littleton Harbour here, probably another 5 millimetres or so here. The colour on the image, it's derived from satellite radar images before the earthquake and after the earthquake. The two images are compared. So it shows us in this red area, the land has lifted slightly, and in the blue area here, it's dropped slightly. So probably in the order of 4 or 5 centimetres up and 4 or 5 centimetres down here. So the blue area that has gone down is just south of the Waimakariri River, and the red area that is lifted up is around about the New Brighton area